Good evening. How are you guys all doing?
Great.
This is an excellent turnout. I was kind of expecting maybe a few less people, but I'm really excited. Well, thank you very much for coming out to the debate. I love when an opportunity like this happens and a community of people can get together, depending on what they believe, and talk to each other. It tends to be a little bit that when you come to a debate like this, we all come in very firm in what we believe and what we think and what defines our lives. And what we believe affects our actions, and we tend to hold on very, very tightly as if somebody's going to change our mind or our world's going to change. I encourage you tonight, as we talk, as we listen, as we share, to kind of take a deep breath and relax and don't worry about what's being said so much as what you're considering and how it can affect your life. Don't worry about somebody changing you. I hope that you can have a conversation with your own heart. Tonight we're going to do a couple different things. We're going to have a little bit of a flow to the evening. We're going to start firstly with our debate. After the debate section is over, we're going to move into a Q&A section. So if you guys want to write down questions, most of you in front of your chair should have a little white piece of paper and there should be a pen or a pencil. Feel free to jot those down throughout the evening. Hold on to those, and then at the night, come back up after the debate and I'll let you know when we're starting our Q&A section. We'll go over the rules a second time. And what you can do at that time is stand in the aisle in front of the panel that you'd like to ask a question for. You'll be given 30 seconds to do so, just to kind of keep it brief so we can get as many questions in as possible. And then they'll go ahead and respond. If you do have a follow-up question at that point, please feel free to ask it. But we leave it to our moderator to make sure that everything is being kept as succinct as possible so that we can get through as many questions as possible. So, basic housekeeping ideas. We're not going to take a break in between the Q&A and the actual debate. If you guys do need to use the restroom or if you guys need water or anything like that, everything's going to be out in the main entrance to your left. If we could just keep everything going in and out of that door, that would be fantastic. As for our panelists, we have an interesting, great group of guys. I'd love to kind of give you some more background information. Over here on my right, we have Bernie Dehler, and we have Tom, I'm going to say this wrong, I apologize, Gebhardt, sorry, bad, that's me. Very humbly, right off the bat, these gentlemen would both like you guys to know. They don't think that they speak for every atheist or secular humanist, whatever you prefer to call them. In the world, they're really speaking for themselves and from their hearts and from their own beliefs and experiences and what they think is the best, most accountable action. So they don't claim to speak for everybody, but they would like to speak with you tonight. I'd like to start with Tom. Tom said his very satisfying Christian upbringing for about 25 years until several years of honest, free inquiry into the topics and questions that matter in the world ultimately moved him away from the faith. Now, finally, knowing himself and what he really wants to do with the next 10 years or so of his life, Tom plans to go back to college in January to pursue a degree in psychology or in sociology. Bernie has a bachelor in science degree from OIT, and he also has a master's in ministry from Luther Rice University. He received that in 2007. He's been working in the computer industry since 1984, and Bernie also left Christianity and belief in the supernatural altogether in September of 2009. He still has many healthy interests and relationships with the Christian community, and he has a healthy interest in understanding in the Bible as well from every aspect. Bernie is a secular humanist and a member of various local humanist and atheist groups, which I can attest to. I've been honored to go to a lot of debates so far and see both these guys interact with the community. And open up a lot of questions and inquiry for people on both sides. Which leads us to our other gentlemen, Ben Clifton and Jeremy Wallace. Ben Clifton gave his life to Jesus in 1997, after God changed his heart away from atheism. After his heart changed, Ben began pursuing an intellectual side of the Christian life and remains passionate about the reasonableness of the Christian faith. In pursuit, he has taken numerous classes through Canby Bible College. He has presided over the Portland chapter of the Science and Faith think tank, say that three times fast, Reasons to Believe, and participated in a number of dialogues and debates about the intersection of Christian faith and reason, Most recently, Ben is working on his master's degree program in Christian apologetics through Biola University in Los Angeles. And Ben has worked in the high-tech area of digital flat panel and projection displays most of his career, and is currently the VP of technology at Planar Systems in Beaverton. Ben and his wife, Joey, and their kids, Jaden, and are regular attendees at Canby New Life. And finally, Dr. Jeremy Wallace, an ordained Foursquare minister, has been assisting pastor at Canby Foursquare since 2001. He has been an instructor of ministry at Canby Bible College since 2001 as well, and has served as dean of the college since 2005. He has received a BA in biblical literature from Oral Roberts University in 1998, studied at Jerusalem University College in 2000, and took the MDiv from ORU's Graduate School of Theology and Missions in 2001. He completed his doctoral studies in 2009 at Western Seminary in Portland with a D.Min in ministerial leadership. Jeremy also serves as adjunct professor of Bible and Theology at Life Pacific College in San Dimas, California. He and his wife Rebecca have three daughters and a brand new baby boy. There you go. That was waiting for the oohs and ahs. Tonight, I would also like to let you know, at the end, these gentlemen, amongst a few others, are going to be here to answer questions that we don't get to in the Q&A time if we have too many. Or if you're feeling a little bit sheepish or you just didn't think about it, we're going to be waiting around in the foyer or in here, just kind of hanging out when it's all done. Feel free to talk to each other. I encourage it, and talk to these gentlemen and find out more. Learn more what they believe, and hopefully we can walk out with a better understanding of what everybody's going on. So if you have a question for somebody, look for these gentlemen or look for somebody with your name tag, like that illustrious, beautiful name tag. And there'll be a couple gentlemen to answer questions for you. And finally, before we get started, I feel I should kind of ask you guys a little favor for the rules. Rules are pretty simple. No matter how adult we all are, we tend to roll our eyes a lot if you haven't checked recently, or laugh when it's maybe not the most appropriate. So I would encourage you, as fallacious as some of these things might sound to you, or as genius as they are, or as much as they might agree with what you believe, let's try our best not to laugh or roll our eyes or scoff. I'm not saying you fine people would ever do that, but I've done it, caught myself doing it, and I just want to make sure that we're giving the utmost respect that we can. I also would like to introduce Ken Shonk. He's also one of the professors here at CBC. He has a master's in theological studies and church history. He's going to be our moderator tonight. He's going to try and keep things short. Don't get angry with him. Wants to make sure that everybody's going to get their questions and their answers in a reasonable time, so you guys aren't going to be here forever. And on that, finally, I have one last request, and we will get this guy started. Life has meaning. I got very few and very interesting responses when I've asked people that question over the last couple of weeks. Does life have meaning? Most people will give you one of two. One, yes, it means something to me, and they leave it at that. Or two, I don't know, and then they walk away. It doesn't get too deep, unfortunately. Our generation, my generation, tends to be the generation that a lot of people say has a problem with entitlement. We feel very entitled that we deserve certain things, and we don't work for them. I can say that I've had that problem before in my life as well. When material things come into the picture, that's one thing. But when you look from any view, whether it be Christian or a different belief or atheism, at the reason why you're here, I don't think you can afford to take that for granted. I don't think you can afford to have that handed to you. I would really, really again encourage you to ask honestly and inquire honestly with your own self and with your own belief systems and worldviews, courageously so, and ask, does life have meaning? It tends to be that easy question that you look at and you say, it does. But it is shockingly much deeper than that. I think the road that you start on when you ask yourself that question will go much deeper than your comfort zone might want to take you, and I encourage you to push past that. Maybe you've thought about it before, and I'm just blowing hot air, but that's fine too. I really, 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 really hope that we can all talk together, hang out tonight, have a good time, and enjoy a good discussion, and learn a whole heck of a lot. With that, we are going to get this debate rolling, and I will hand this off to Pastor Kencho.
Thank you very much. Good job, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, so while they're talking up here, I'm going to be texting different... No, I'm kidding. My timer is on my phone, and so that's one of my jobs, is to make sure that everybody gets a fair and balanced time to bring their points across in the rebuttals. I did the coin toss in the back, and we are going to open with opening statements, 7 minutes for each person, and the first one to start off on the coin toss is Dr. Jeremy Wallace.
I'll make sure I get it. Just kidding. How's everybody doing?
Great.
Yeah. Good. Good evening and welcome. This is exciting. This is my first formal public debate, and so I'm very much looking forward to a lively exchange of ideas. And I must say that that I hope you find this to be a valuable experience. As we tackle the question, does life have meaning? What we're trying to do is to make sense of our lives. We're trying to interpret our significance. Are we here on purpose? Are we here on accident? Is any sense of meaning that we have and that we carry with us in our lives, is it grounded in something outside of ourselves? Or is it something that we determine for ourselves? The very fact that we have are having this discussion tonight, I think, ought to be instructive. Are we to make sense even of the search for meaning? Can we make sense of making sense out of life? I'd like to suggest tonight, due to time constraints, that there are at least three reasons why belief in objective meaning is rationally justifiable. The first is that the world and every physical particle and physical thing within it is in fact the creation of an infinite, all-purposeful, all-loving creator. The world has been designed by this great designer in such a way that we are even possible. The very uniformity and regularity of the cosmos are held together by this self-existent, necessary being. In fact, the triune God of Scripture is the source of all meaning in life and is the grounding for all truth, beauty, love, peace, goodness, and value. Everything He does is meaningful, and everything He creates is imbued with meaning. The very design of this universe, with all its beauty and complexity, implies a designer. We are purposeful creatures. Every time we use phrases like in order to or so that, we demonstrate an awareness of design and purpose all around us. The very search for meaning and the discovery of it is justified because, as the psalmist once put it, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. Second, human life is intrinsically valuable because mankind was created in the image of God. The Judeo-Christian doctrine of the Imago Dei is the best explanation for human self-consciousness and free will. Humanity has been given its worth by the creator of the universe, and mankind has innate knowledge of our creatureliness. In John Calvin's Institutes of the Christian Religion, he puts it well when he says, "All wisdom, insofar as it ought to be deemed true and solid, consists almost entirely of two parts, the knowledge of God and knowledge of ourselves." On the Christian view of things, as creatures created in the image of our Creator, we can make sense of our very abilities to think, to love, to know, to feel, and to choose. We think because God thinks, We love because God loves. We have the power of choice because God chooses. And we have knowledge because God knows. We have meaning because God is ultimately the ground of all meaning. Common sense informs us all that we really do matter because our worth and value has been placed in us, not by us, but by our Creator. Third, there's something objectively meaningful about knowledge of the truth and of goodness, love, beauty, and true peace. Each of us demonstrates through everyday life that we're more than simply material beings. We consistently appeal to non-physical entities or authorities, such as morality and reason, and live our lives in pursuit of love, acceptance, and beauty. Each of us, when we're completely honest, see that we are creatures that know and are governed by objective moral values, love, and beauty. And these are intrinsic to our very composition and design. We do find meaning in life, and we do so in full knowledge of the fact that truth and beauty and goodness and love and value are not illusions, nor are they merely human conventions. We don't invent truth. We don't invent goodness. We don't invent love and beauty. Yet they press down upon all of us. We discover them, not determine them. To make a truth claim is to at the same time make the claim that there's something valuable about truth, and that any denial of it or devaluing of truth ought not be done. The more one attempts to deny the ultimate value of meaning is to appeal to an ultimate authority to validate the very claim just made. To deny ultimate values is to affirm the ultimate value of truth and morality. To deny ultimate truth is to affirm the ultimate value and morality of this very truth claim. One cannot escape this dynamic. Every single one of us in this place here tonight can know that we have extraordinary worth and value, for given that God exists and we are His creatures created in His image, life has objective meaning grounded in our Creator. As you might expect, as a minister of the gospel, I must confess that it is my hope and my desire that everyone here would come to know the love and the truth of God in Christ. Thank you.
While Bernie's coming up, can I have the attention of the ushers real quick? There is a handout that Thomas had, an outline. If you can get that ready, see, it's done. If you can get that ready, then when Thomas is speaking, for anybody who wants that outline, we do have that available.
Yes, also before I speak, also, I had an outline also. I have a handout, so please make sure you get this. There's 8 slides on this, and there's a lot of information. I don't know if somebody can maybe pass them out if somebody doesn't have them. Maybe somebody can bring them.
They're out on the table in the back.
I'll get somebody to the back door.
Does anybody need this handout with the slides? There's probably quite a few here. It's like, no, it's fine.
Just keep your hands up while you're talking. We'll have the ushers bring those by. They'll fill that with you. Thank you, Bernie.
Okay. This is a little cartoon. It's actually very deep. I would like you to focus on that for a little bit. Just some preliminary comments. I was raised a Roman Catholic. Around college, I became born again. And then for 25 years, I was a born again Christian. During that time, in fact, I was good friends with Ben Clifton. I think I still am good friends with him. So it's kind of fun to be here tonight. On the bottom of this first slide here, on the handout, you'll see a link to the discussion group. And if you want to discuss this afterwards, you can go to this link and there's a discussion board. Also on my summary slide, there's a link on page 5. Well, that's for the online discussion. On the front page, there's these slides also there. So. Now we'll begin. Next slide. So basically, there's two kinds of, when you talk about the meaning of life, this is something that I think my opposing side isn't getting clear. There's two kinds of meanings on this. There's one kind of meaning that's a transcendent meaning. That means there's something bigger and beyond the people, the earth, from a cosmic perspective. If there's a God, God made you for a reason. It could be as frivolous as for his entertainment. But if he made you for a reason, then it might behoove you to find out what that reason is. That's called a transcendent meaning. If there is no God, there is no transcendent meaning. But there is a temporary meaning in this life that you can develop. And that's what I believe. There is no evidence for God other than what are called arguments from ignorance, saying, how'd this come to be? I don't know. Okay, God did that. Those are called God of the gaps types of arguments. There's no positive evidence for God. So I think there is no evidence for God, therefore we look for a temporary meaning, and I'm going to give you the secret later on how to do that. Next slide. Now, you know, they'll say, well, we don't have any grounding for meaning and stuff. I want to give you my perspective. Not all atheists agree with this, or secular humanists, but I think you need to see everything from a grand overarching scheme of evolution, and it's more than just biology, biological evolution. It starts with cosmological evolution. Talks about how the universe evolved, how chemicals evolved. This is what astronomers actually use this language in astrophysics. A lot of people don't know this. And then eventually life emerged out of non-life, and then we get into biological evolution. And this talks about how life evolves. And then even beyond that, there's a thing called mimetic evolution about thoughts and how thoughts evolve. And what's interesting is our thoughts are evolving so much now we can actually do genetic engineering. So the mimetic evolution is actually going to be affecting biological evolution, which I think is fascinating. So when you think about, instead of God being the creator, it's evolution. Well, you know, everything makes sense now. Things didn't make sense when I was a Christian, but now it makes sense. When I was a Christian, you're wondering, why are these innocent people dying and everything? Well, it makes sense. That's nature. Tsunamis aren't caused by God's wrath. Earthquakes aren't caused by God's wrath. Seriously, they're not. They're caused by plate tectonics. It's not God's wrath. Thunder is not caused by God's wrath. That's what ancient man thought. The gods were angry, we need to sacrifice them, you know, something for them. Thunder and lightning is caused by electrical differences. Why is there evil in the world? That's the way nature works. It's not because there's some loving God who's not looking around or permits it for some reason. This is called theodicy, where Christians try to figure out how is there an all-loving God yet all this incredible pain, and they try to come up with all these answers, and they haven't figured it out yet. If you look up theodicy, you'll find how what a conundrum this is for the theologians. So what's my purpose in life? That's what you assign it. The universe is indifferent to us. We came into the world alone. We'll leave alone. The world doesn't revolve around us, contrary to what ancient man thought. They thought the Earth was very stable. Who can move it? Well, it turns out the Earth is spinning about 1,000 miles per hour. It's going 68,000 miles per hour around the Sun. The Sun is spinning. The Sun is rotating around the Milky Way galaxy. There's a few hundred billion stars in the Milky Way galaxy, just like our Sun. There's a few hundred billion galaxies, and you think there's only one universe? Well, personally, I think there's the multiverse theory. There's even Christians, evangelical Christians, who believe in multiverse theory because there's some basis in string theory on it. It's unproven, but that's the idea. So just as you thought, maybe, you know, there's only one planet, like the ancients thought, like the people who wrote Genesis, you know, now we know, of course, there's not one planet. There's not even one star. Well, it's the same thing, I think, with the universe. So yes, we really do shrink and. And we're shrinking from this egocentric viewpoint where we think it's all about us. You know, if I get hurt, oh, God's trying to teach me a lesson. It's really not about you like that. You're not that important, really. You know, life emerged. You know, if you rewound the tape, you would get something different. You'd be a different person. On the night you were conceived, there's 300 million unique sperm competing for that egg, and they're all unique. A different sperm hit that egg, you'd be a different person right there. Beyond that, even where were you raised at, what religion, that affects how you think. What was your family? Were they rich or poor? That involves how you live. Where did you grow up at? In America, India? That's going to affect you also. So basically, our religion is could be said a way to deal with these facts. How do we do that? Next slide. So one thing to do is to know where you are on Maslow's hierarchy of needs. That's something you can look up on your own. It's a very common thing. Next slide. I want to give you briefly how you can determine purpose for your life. First, determine your values. There's a lot of lists on the internet. I gave mine for an example. Determine your personality type. I gave mine there. Determine your position in Maslow's hierarchy of needs. If you don't have a job, that's going to be job number one for you. If you have a job and a loving family and all that, you can reach for total empowerment and considering these high-level questions like we are tonight. So determining those three things, you make short and long-term goals, and that's how your life will have meaning. So thank you.
Thank you all for the opportunity to discuss this very important question of whether or not life has meaning. In Jeremy's opening statement, he affirmed, as I do, that life does have objective meaning if the theistic worldview is true, and that life's meaning is grounded in God's will in nature, discoverable through his revelation. In my opening statement, I will argue three main points. First, if God does not exist, then life does not have objective purpose, value, or hope. That is, life is meaningless. Second, that attempts to construct a subjective meaning to life are ultimately meaningless because the subjective meaning has no foundation. And third, that the meaninglessness of life afforded by the atheistic worldview is unlivable, even by those who would defend it. This is clear when we see that the meaning that atheists create for themselves invariably sneak in concepts of purpose, value, and hope that are foundationless on their worldview. From these three points, I can't see any good reason why anyone should accept the meaningless and incoherent life of atheism. So let's look at my first point, that if God does not exist, then life does not have objective meaning. By objective meaning, I mean purpose, values, and hope that are true about those objects themselves, regardless of whether people believe them or not. This is as opposed to subjective meaning, which means what people, that is, subjects, believe these to be. In other words, objective meaning is true independent of people, and subjective meaning is based on personal preference. Objective meaning is discovered, whereas subjective meaning is made up. On atheism, there is no basis for any objective purpose, value, or hope in life. Without God, the picture that Bernie's evolutionary framework paints is that we are, at root, simply molecules in motion, the accidental coming together of matter and energy, purposely driven through time by the blind and indifferent forces of nature. How then can purpose be created by accident? This is a contradiction in terms. Likewise, the concepts of value like beauty, goodness, and human worth are without foundation on atheism. For without God, there is no arbiter of what is of value and what is not of value. What is good and evil if there's no moral law to judge these by? And how can there be a moral law without a moral lawgiver? Without purpose and value, there can be no hope. Hope to what purpose? Hope to attain what value? On atheism, all the pursuits of man matter not and will end in the same insignificance in the death of the universe. Only the boldest of atheists, such as Nietzsche, Bertrand Russell, Sartre, and Camus, are willing to follow the logic of their atheistic worldview to see it end in its meaninglessness. As Russell says, we must build our lives upon the firm foundation of undying despair. And millennia before them, the wisest man who ever lived saw this too, concluding that under the sun, that is, without God, all is meaningless. But many atheists, while acknowledging the lack of objective meaning without God, cannot face the bleak outworkings of their worldview and attempt to construct their own subjective meaning, that is, to create their own meaning out of the godless vacuum. Why, like Adam and Eve, they ask, can't we create for ourselves our own hope, our own value, and our own purpose? This leads us to my second point. Any subjective meaning we create for ourselves is itself without foundation and ultimately meaningless. The problem is that a self-constructed meaning to life is arbitrary without some objective foundation by which to support it. To any proposed purpose we create, we simply ask, but what is the purpose of that purpose? If we ask, why is such and such my purpose in life, we need to answer with some underlying reason. And this reason itself must have its justification by another reason, and so on. At some point, this regression must find an anchor at some ultimate purpose, which, on atheism, is found in God, but on atheism, is zero and non-existent. Thus, all of the purposes we create for ourselves vanish when multiplied by the ultimate purposelessness of atheism. This same bankruptcy befalls the concepts of value and hope on atheism. With no objective measure of value, atheism cannot defend any subjective values we may choose to create. Likewise, with no objective hope, any subjective hope that atheism offers is ultimately hopeless. Built on foundations of sand, the illusion of meaning constructed with the meager resources of atheism evaporates under the scrutiny of reason. This is evident even as we dialogue today. For if we can simply construct our own meaning, what's to say that the meaning found in God that I am defending now is any less meaningful than that proposed by our atheist friends here? And if it's just as meaningful as their view, then what is the meaning of our debate tonight? Surely our friends here have come for some meaningful reason. And it is meaningful, but only because they are mistaken on their view of the meaning of life. My third point is this, that the meaninglessness of life offered by the atheistic worldview is unlivable. No atheist lives as if life was purposeless, valueless, and hopeless. This is evident by the very meaningful lives that atheists live out every day. Despite the fact that they don't believe it, objective purpose, value, and hope really do exist, rooted in God's will and nature. And while the atheists may intellectually deny any objective meaning in life, they certainly live as if their lives did have meaning, and thus betray the unlivability of their worldview that they defend. For example, many atheists seek to promote their worldview, believing that it is the truth, and that the pursuit of truth is meaningful and good. But why is this true on atheism? Many atheists have done wonderfully good things that have benefited humanity in the belief that humans are valuable and that promoting their well-being is a meaningful pursuit. But again, why is this true on atheism? Without God, all of these noble pursuits are ultimately without foundation. Thus, the atheist lives a contradictory life, denying on the one hand that life has objective meaning, while on the other hand, living their lives full of objective meaning. This contradictory life strikes at the heart of the value that atheism holds most dearly, that of intellectual honesty. Yet even the value of intellectual honesty itself is only meaningful in a theistic worldview where honesty has objective value. Thus, the atheist is in a no-win situation, at each turn, running into the self-refuting nature of life without objective meaning in a godless existence. And this is unlivable and leads to a life of contradiction. In summary, let me return to my three points. I've contended that without God, life has no objective meaning. I've also contended that any meaning that we try to create for ourselves out of the vacuum of godlessness is ultimately meaningless. And finally, I've contended that a meaningless existence is essentially unlivable, and thus I'm confident that we'll have a meaningful discussion tonight. Thank you very much.
Welcome, everyone. My handout starts with, does life have meaning? But many of you are here today who are specifically interested in the question, does life have a transcendent meaning? I have four reflections on why life has no transcendent meaning. If life does have a transcendent meaning, one should expect morality, for example, to have an ultimate transcendent source from which it flows, from which it comes from. However, number one, there's no objective evidence for there being an ultimate source to our morality or truth or beauty, etc. This is a relevant question. If there's no source such as God to one's morality, for example, will morality just then be relative and basically meaningless with no real substance because it has no ultimate source? To keep my intellectual integrity, I need to work with that which has explanatory power. And I find the best explanation for how morality came about in evolutionary psychology. So I'm okay with there not being a transcendent meaning in life, such as with morality, but instead a morality that came about through evolution, because my mind finds this is actually intellectually satisfying. Next topic, if life does not have a transcendent meaning, one should expect there to be evidence of us being the primary focus of creation. However, number two, there's no objective evidence that we were made by a creator with us in mind. If we were made by a creator with us in mind, I then need answers to, for example, why so much extinction needed to take place before we came on the scene in this world. The best evidence out there suggests that we've only been a species able to consciously appreciate our environment for about 200,000 years. So the evidence tells me we are definitely not a centerpiece, if you will, of creation, but have only happened to come on the scene very, very recently on an evolutionary timescale. I could also mention designed and badly designed features of the body, but that doesn't convince that don't convince me of a thoughtful designer. But the focus here tonight is that there's nothing to suggest we were made by a creator with us in mind. If life does have a transcendent meaning, one should expect a universe that complements us and our life-sustaining planet. However, number three, there's no objective evidence that the universe was made for our benefit or that we are the central reason for the existence of this universe. The only beneficial reason we have with the universe is that the Earth is located in what astronomers call the Goldilocks zone. The distance from a star where an Earth-like planet can maintain liquid water on its surface. This evidence doesn't communicate to me that the universe was made for our benefit, but it does tell me that our planet found a niche in its cosmic environment for life. In the same way, an environment was not created for a species to live in it, but species adapt to their environment and so fit in their environment. So the universe doesn't fit us, but we very fragilely fit our universe. If life does have a transcendent meaning, one should expect it to be of primary importance everywhere and frequently found throughout the cosmos. However, number four, there is no objective evidence that life is a hallmark signature of the cosmos. So far, from what we can tell, the universe is mostly made from non-life and is much more of an environment for the thriving of black holes, which feed on radiation, planets, stars, etc. What life we have on Earth is a fragile system at best, protected by a thin ozone layer. Here's the more positive side of my presentation, but life does have meaning for me and is meaningful. Number one, because I make my own meaning in my life. I am my own meaning maker. This meaning which I create in my daily life gives me a purpose and direction, and this makes my life significant. In all respect, in my opinion, most if not all those who are believers here tonight subconsciously or consciously reflexively make meaning in their lives without always praying to God or feeling led by the Holy Spirit to make those decisions. Why does that happen? And I find it very revealing that there are many secular people out there whose lives are just as satisfying as believers, because both are focused on making meaning in their lives. They just simply have different frameworks within which to make their lives meaningful. Number two, human life is intrinsically valuable. When I think of human life as intrinsically valuable, I think of our desire to survive and that of a species. We have a deeply ingrained evolutionary instinct to ensure our species survival and to personally survive. This is instinctive to us and so feels natural. And it's hard to separate that life is intrinsically valuable to us from it also having a transcendent element to us. And many of us here feel there is this connection. And I want to understand why there is this bent towards what they would call anthropocentrism, the tendency for human beings to regard themselves as the central and most significant entities in the universe. Number three, because our minds are built for finding patterns, connecting the dots and attaching significance to those patterns. To quote Michael Shermer, humans are pattern-seeking, storytelling animals. We look for and find patterns in our world and in our lives, then weave narratives around those patterns to bring them to life and give them meaning, such as the stuff of which myth, religion, history, and science are made. So something can be meaningful to us and not be based in reality, because that is how our mind is built. We see images in the clouds, for example. So I am built to find meaning and patterns and events, etc., that are meaningful to me and make this life worth meaning. And a fourth one is that we comprehend and appreciate the world and the universe. But to conclude right here, so even though life, to the best of my understanding, does not have transcendent meaning, I still am driven instinctively to put meaning into my life and make it worth living. Thank you.
Now each group will have 10 minutes for rebuttal, and the other group will have 1 minute to rebut the rebuttal. So, Dream, you're representing your group.
Okay. Some general thoughts here. What we've heard from our opponents here is that two things are valuable: creating your own meaning and knowledge of the truth. Mr. Dehler says that we're to create our values, and so does Mr. Gebhardt. That introduces a very difficult proposition, in that we have free rein to create our own values. If we determine our values and don't discover a value system or some sort of standard of values, that opens up the door for mayhem, chaos, and you versus me. And there is no standard. There is no substantiated claim that there's something valuable about making your own values. If it's purely subjective and it's you choosing your values and me choosing my values, there is no sort of standard by which to measure these values. C.S. Lewis once said that whenever you compare two set of values, you're in fact comparing both of them by a standard to make sense of those. We understand this in everyday life, that we need a standard in order to measure anything or to make any sort of claim as something being better than or worse than another. Not only that, the very claim itself seems to be anchored in truth, or a propositional truth claim, that making your own meaning is meaningful. On the atheistic or naturalistic worldview, how can one account for such a truth claim? Because there can be no objective truth within a purely naturalistic, material, physical world. But we know that truth does exist, and truth seeking is valuable. Why? Because there's something objectively valuable about seeking and knowing the truth. See, you're in a very difficult spot if you say life is basically about constructing your own set of values. It, from the outset, is making a value claim, which we're to reject if everything is purely subjective. Now, regarding the idea that the universe has no evidence of being for our benefit, that Mr. Gebhardt says, and yet we're here having a debate. The incredible regularity and uniformity of the cosmos to even allow for a life-permitting planet on which life can exist seems to be toward our benefit. We have the ability to even have a conversation, to live, to flourish. That seems to me a contradiction in terms. Next, Tom's idea that our minds are built to recognize patterns. This is assuming purpose and design into the very discussion. If our minds are built to receive and understand knowledge and have truth, what is truth? Well, truth is governed by the laws of logic, which are not physical entities. Why would they be governing our discussion about anything? If these laws of logic, which are non-physical in the universe and point towards objective truth, if we encounter those, then we must see that there is design in the universe, that we are created in such a way that we can think and feel and choose and have loving relationships and recognize beauty. That itself is evidence of the objective meaning of the universe. You heard the idea of transcendent meaning versus temporary meaning. We're talking about objective meaning or subjective meaning. Very similar concepts of what we're talking about. Either something is true, whether we believe it or not, and if it is, then it's objectively true. Either there are values that are not constructed by us, that are valuable whether or not we believe them to be valuable, or they're not. And if there are, then there are objective values. It seems to me that on the purely naturalistic worldview, the atheist friend colleagues up here are in a pickle. On one hand, if you say that life is ultimately meaningless, the statement of making that you're making right there is not meaningless to be taken as true. On the other hand, if you grant objective meaning, then you're recognizing that you're borrowing from a Christian worldview, which you can't account for. So there's an attempt to have a halfway house between these two, where you say, well, of course there's meaning to life. It's what we make, the values that we make, the meaning that we construct ourselves. But when you do that, you're actually appealing to a standard beyond your subjective claim, which proves that there's an objective truth about the value of subjective meaning, which shows that there is objective truth and there's something objectively valuable about that truth claim. That shows contradiction. And I'll yield the rest of my time to my colleague, Mr. Clifton.
So the first thing I want to say is Mr. Gebhardt's points about no objective evidence for morality, truth, no objective evidence that we were made by a creator with us in mind, no objective evidence that the universe was made for our benefit, and no objective evidence that life is a hallmark signature in the cosmos. On many of these points, Tom is simply wrong. There is tremendous evidence for fine-tuning in the universe. The universe is clear, has been demonstrated by science to have a beginning, which requires a beginner. It has all the hallmark of design, which requires a designer. I think we all agree that there are objective truths, such as one plus one is two is true, and that objective morality really does exist, like torturing babies for fun is really wrong, regardless of whether we believe it or not. So there's a lot of objective evidence for a creator. I wanted to address Bernie's point about creating our own purpose and the central role of evolution that plays. Now, he says that the creation of everything, or the creator of everything, isn't God. The creator of everything is evolution. Now, he can't really mean this, because evolution is a process. It's a mechanism that operates on matter, energy, space, and time through the laws of physics. And it's those things themselves that we are trying to explain. So evolution can't self-create itself. In addition, evolution is, as Bernie says, is not driven by any purpose. There's no purpose in it. And so at the end, we're all just molecules in motion, granted arranged in different ways, but we came here completely by accident. So my question is, how does an accidental process create purpose? How do we have a purpose on accident? It seems to me like a contradiction in terms. And this is really the fundamental issue I see with the atheistic worldview, is that it contradicts itself, it's self-refuting in affirming values that don't exist within its own worldview. So in a nutshell, I think there is objective evidence or objective evidence for a transcendent creator, and that that evolution does not explain how evolution itself came into being. Thanks.
10 minutes. However you guys want to divide that up.
Well, 10 minutes.
Yes.
Okay. We'll do 5 minutes each. So you know, 5 minutes is actually equal to the other things.
Okay, lots of things to talk about. Okay, so Jeremy started off with his rebuttal about talking about values, which really wasn't this discussion tonight. That's a whole other thing, but let me just talk about this. When it comes to values or ethics or what's right and wrong, there's a lot of philosophy on that. There's some different philosophical ideas. One of them is called divine theory. That means God said it, therefore that's what you're supposed to do. There's another one called consequentialism, which I think is correct, and that's where you base what's right or wrong based on outcomes, whether it's beneficial or harmful. Another principle for determining values is reciprocity. Do unto others as you want them to do unto you. A wise man said that. Anybody know who that was? Jesus? Before Jesus, it was Confucius? You know, so it doesn't take a lot of brains to figure out what works. It's kind of what people have figured out what to do. And also, now, so, you know, supposedly we need God for values and things. Well, the problem is they can't even agree amongst themselves. So why does God be grounding, but his people don't know what the answers are? Look at euthanasia. I mean, I would consider it mercy killing. Even as a Christian, I thought it'd be okay. And then some Christians say, no, it's a sinful, you can't unplug the machine. It's, you know, why can't they agree if these things are from God? Of course, some of them are obvious. Rape is bad, yeah. Helping somebody get a poor person is good. But some of them are tricky, and that's where you gotta use your brain and think about consequences and reciprocity and other kind of principles to decide. Ben talks a lot about how atheism is so deep and dark, it's unlivable. Okay, well, I think with some thinking about it, I think we would agree that you don't follow what sounds good. You follow the truth. And even you can say Christianity sounds dark and not too good either. I mean, if you're really a really good Christian, maybe you should be like a lot of these missionaries who went overseas and they died right away. There have been waves of missionaries sent to other countries. They get over there and die of malaria right away. You never heard of them. What missionaries have you heard of? Oh, the famous ones, yeah. But, you know, there's probably 1,000 for every one of those that just died. Some of these guys, you know, they're like doormats. They'll give their whole life for God. Wow, that sounds fun. Not really. But so why do you do it? Because you think it's true. So you should follow the truth and let the consequences fall. And the reason why you want to follow the truth is because if you're not in the truth, you're going to get slapped around real hard by reality. And that's even more painful. Jeremy said it's a big deal. We're on a life-permitting planet. Or, yeah, well, I don't think it's that big of a deal, really. Again, I think actually life is probably, I believe it's probably very common in the universe. The problem is that the other sun or stars are so far away, we can't really make contact with those that have life. You know, again, consider how vast everything is. It's something we can't comprehend because we don't work on that scale. But, you know, our sun, we have a solar system. Well, how many other stars are like that in our galaxy? There's hundreds of billions of them. And then how many galaxies are? There's hundreds of billions of them. So, I mean, if you just had a fraction of a fraction of a fraction of a percent, you got high likelihood. But they're so far away, we can't really see that. So, you know, you can have a negative opinion and say, oh, this little Earth here is the only little Garden of Eden that there's life and everything else is dead. You can believe that if you want to, but I don't think it's good with probability. It might be like the ancients thinking that, you know, the world was flat and they lived right here and that was the only civilization. They didn't know about people on the other side of the world. Oh, and as far as design, well, there's a lot of web pages about terrible design. You know, if God's a designer, talk about intelligent design, there's very unintelligent design. There's a famous case of the recurrent laryngeal nerve. You know, in fish, it's very short. It goes from, like, the head to the neck. But with evolution, as animals came on the land, part of that nerve got stuck behind the heart. And so when the heart went down, it went with it. So now in the giraffe, they have this long nerve that goes all the way down around the heart and back up again. It only has to go a little bit, but it's taking like a 15-foot route. Why? Well, it works good enough for evolution, but why would an intelligent designer do something like that? It's crazy, because now you're causing all kind of unnecessary medical problems if that gets hurt and things. So, and there's a lot of examples like that. it makes perfect sense with evolution. It doesn't make any sense with a so-called designer or an intelligent designer who's supposed to be making these creatures by miracle. And yes, I do. He said, Ben said, I can't really believe that evolution is a creator. Yes, I do. And yes, I agree, it is a process. And this process, I believe, created everything. So, what would you say, 5 seconds? Okay, thank you.
Not used to this part, so bear with me. Thanks to Jeremy and Ben for your presentations. If it said, on atheism, there's no objective purpose, value, or hope. It's very hard to understand how one would be able to determine let's say that's the case. I'm not sure exactly how that affects us, because where I'm coming from is that there are biological, psychological aspects to us that cause us to have this meaning and purpose, and to look for patterns and give ourselves significance. Jeremy said we demonstrate the awareness of desire and purpose around us. Well, I agree with that. We do demonstrate the awareness of desire and purpose around us. Not sure if that you can go from that to that there is something transcendent. See, I really feel that if there's just so much about our bodies, our minds, that we're still trying to learn. Each of you probably have benefited at a time in your life where you sought to get to the bottom of yourself, to unravel yourself. In doing so, you learn so much more about you. A lot of us are busy with our daily lives, and so it's hard for us to really get into the serious questions and understand why and how we do what we do. But there's this human mind, mental tendency to find something that is attractive, to conclude on it, and to pretty much, you know, stay in that place and not really welcome people to challenge what we value, what we believe. It was also said on atheism, any purpose, value, or hope we create for ourselves has no foundation and is ultimately meaningless. Again, I wonder what exactly they mean by foundation. Now, it is definitely a much more attractive foundation for something to be a powerful narrative to be found in the Word of God. It's a very breathtaking book, over 2,000 years. There's, again, that human tendency to want to believe that. And that's fine. That's a fact that these beliefs to you are very important. And I want to respect that and understand that. There's too many people who don't want to respect that, understand that, but want to debate that. Ben said only Nietzsche's and others were willing to follow the logical progression of their atheistic worldview. But what about the ethical worldview? Atheism is just what we don't believe. But the question still remains, how now should one live their lives? And it's just as important to a non-believer as a believer how they should live their lives. You probably only see too many atheists or hear about them in the news, and you know they don't believe in God, but one doesn't know the person. For me, it's just as important, if not even more important now, to live my life, because I know there's one life to live. And when it's done, that's all she wrote. You know, it's over. So life has become incalculably precious to me. The moments of life are that much more important to me than, in all respect, when I was a Christian. So it's that much more serious. And so it's easy to do debates like this where we make these summaries, but I'm glad that we're here to have these discussions so that we can really complicate things, because people are complicated. Another thing that was said, but the atheist cannot live a meaningless life and invariably lives with objective purpose, value, and hope. that are not supported by the atheistic worldview? Well, I would challenge you to get to know us more. There's a book written by Richard Carrier called Sense and Goodness Without God, A Defense of Metaphysical Naturalism. Forget the subtitles, a little complicated, Defense of Goodness Without God. For me, it presented a whole world view of naturalism. It's important to have a worldview. It allows me to have meaning and purpose in my life and to have explanations. And in the same respect, each of you who are believers, turn to your Bible for that same worldview.